एवरीवन, आई डॉक्टर निधि नलवाया, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, फैकल्टी ऑफ कॉमर्स, पारुल यूनिवर्सिटी, वेलकम यू ऑल इन द सीरीज ऑफ वेबिनार एट पारुल यूनिवर्सिटी. द वेबिनार्स आर बीइंग कंडक्टेड विद द एक्सप्रेस ऑब्जेक्टिव ऑफ ब्रिजिंग द गैप बिटवीन इंडस्ट्री एंड एकेडमिक्स एंड टू अंडरस्टैंड द इमर्जिंग ट्रेंड्स एंड फ्यूचर इम्प्लीकेशन ऑफ वेरियस डिमेंशंस इन बिजनेस. Automation is important because finance is now playing a major role in driving the direction of businesses, and digital transformation is the call of the day. With this view, today's topic of webinar is being organized by Faculty of Commerce on role of intelligent automation in changing dimensions of finance and accounting. I take the privilege to introduce our eminent guest speaker, Mr. Prakash Nahar, a chartered accountant by profession and currently working as Assistant Vice President, Genpec Hyderabad. Mr. Nahar draws upon decades of experience in both the advisory and investment side of reputed multinational companies across the globe. Mr. Nahar has a unique perspective and valuable experience, particularly in the areas of strategic assessment, service delivery of complex operations, and finance accounting process designing. He has also been instrumental in implementing intelligent process automation for many Fortune 500 companies like Abbott, Carlsberg, and Chubb Insurance, etc. in USA and Europe, and has set up a center for excellence for these companies as well. He is the holder of the right to use the Chartered Financial Analyst designation. So hereby, I, Dr. Nidhi, extend a warm welcome from Faculty of Commerce, Parul University. All the participants are requested to post the question in a chat box, which we'll be discussing in the end or the last 5 minutes of the session. So without taking a lot of my time, all the participants are eagerly looking forward to this session. So I hand over the session to you, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Nidhi Nalvaya. And thanks to the entire Parul University's management team for giving this an opportunity. And I think this is a kind of good platform to interact with students and just to, I think, guide them in terms of what industry is looking for, how is the future exactly looks like for them, how the dimensions of finance and accounting is changing and shaping up in a new environment wherein the technology is playing actually a lot of role eventually. So I think it's a good opportunity, and we can make it interactive. I request all the students to feel free to jump in wherever if they feel that they have a question, or you can park your questions for the end, and we can address them also either way, where whatever is suitable to you guys. I'm fine with that. So, on today's agenda, we are going to discuss a few of these key elements, and I will take you through with what exactly is general accounting meaning here, or the finance and accounting function. So finance and accounting function is basically a very big organization within the organization, or we can call it as a CFO organizations, which has a different divisions, different departments. And normally as a student, what we do is we just study the accountings or the ways of accountings, like golden rules, the key principles, and all those kind of stuff. But in a real scenario, if you look at that, the accounting function is divided in a different way within the organizations. So I will take you through with that. So how exactly industry is divided, what are the activities they include in which department, and what do they call that? So I think you get familiar with the terminologies which industry is using at this, or in terms of the overall finance and accounting. And what are the different dimensions of general accounting? So that I will just take you through. Or for any process, what are the different dimensions, and we can just connect and correlate that with your day-to-day life, or any project if you are doing, or any activity which you do during your day. And you will see that I think that's kind of completely correlated with these emerging technologies. The dimensions are changing because of the technology. So I will take you through with that, the role of the intelligent automation on those dimensions. Though the overall finance and accounting function is going to be remain same, but the way of doing or the way of executing the transactions is completely changing. It's taking a complete change from that sense. I will also spend some time on what is in it for you. You are a kind of a student today, but eventually you are looking or you are aspiring for some better opportunities within the industry. So how can you prepare better for tomorrow and be vigilant what exactly is happening within the industry and get yourself ready for tomorrow? So I think that's another aspect which we will talk about that. And then what industry wants. So I think it's a very important to bridge the gap. What is in there for you and what industry is looking for. If you can bridge that gap, I think it will be a kind of win-win situation for both. Of course, we will talk about a lot of digital interventions, the new emerging technologies. So, moving on. So, in large, if we say general accounting, and I'll just give you a kind of brief idea how the different departments are functioning within these companies. So, let's take an example of a manufacturing organization. For example, a beverages company like Coca-Cola or Pepsi or anything. Or any medical or pharmaceutical company, they need to procure a lot of different raw materials, different materials to manufacture their product, and for that they have hundreds of vendors who supply the materials to them. At the same time, they need to acquire the plants, the machineries, and land and building. To have their factory set up, and they keep on improving on that. At the same time, they have to have a kind of office set up so that they manage their selling administrative kind of departments within that factory setup or within that company. Consider all these different scenarios. If let's say I have to acquire a raw material from hundreds of people, or I have to have utility bills, telephone bills, or any other bills which I need to pay. I receive hundreds of invoices or thousands of invoices in some big companies every day. Now, do I need an army to manage all the invoices, or how do I conduct the entire end-to-end processing of those invoices? Because invoicing is just a simple process. If you look at that, you receive an invoice, basis the purchase order you issue, and then you have to make a payment. But it's not as simple as it sounds, because there are a lot of audit happens. You need to match the quantity, whatever is there on the invoices. You need to match the amount. You need to match the calculations, and then accordingly you process. There is a kind of approval process, and approval also happens at a different levels, so there are threshold limits defined, all those kind of things happens, and then finally it goes for payment. The another team or the treasury team or treasury function within the departments process the payments, and it goes through the sales team or the purchase team. Similarly, whenever these companies sell their products, they have to raise invoice from their end and then collect the money. So it's a kind of linkages between in material procurement as well as selling of their end products. Now, how do they structure? The structure is like they create a team of people who just takes care of all the invoices, right from the suppliers, utilities, telephone, fixed assets, land and building, lease, all those kind of stuff. And they call it as their accounts payable function. So that's the accounts payable function. Wherein all payments related invoices, which they have to make the payment, is taken care by one team. Then in between there is a general accounting team, which takes care of different aspects like recording of general entries. They perform account reconciliations. They create a P&L, profit and loss account, balance sheet and all those kind of stuff. Intercompany accounting happens within the different entities of the organizations. Then there is a fixed assets accounting. So let's say if there's any plant, machineries or the land, building they have need to acquire, there is a separate procedure for that. They need to open a kind of project for that, and the installation goes on, and on the basis of the valuations they receive from valuers or the plant head, they need to do a kind of capitalization in their books. And then they run a kind of depreciation on that. They calculate the depreciation depending upon their accounting policies, depending upon what kind of books they are maintaining. If it is a kind of US GAAP books, basis the US GAAP accounting, they need to run the depreciation. Then it also have to prepare the local GAAP books. Then they have to run the depreciation according to that. So there's a whole lot of efforts in that. And then finally, every month they need to close their books. When I say close their, that means there is a specific cutoff date every month on which they need to close their books for that particular period, so that they can finally create a report for their management in terms of their overall profitability or loss, or in terms of different management informations or management kind of reporting. At the same time, these companies are also bounded to file some, if these are the listed companies in stock exchanges, they need to file some certain reports. There are some external reports which they need to file. SOX compliance is another aspect wherein they have to do a kind of control audits. So a lot of those reports gets generated. So once they decide on the cutoff date, after that they generate all the reportings, P&L, balance sheet, and then they have to file those reports after audit, or sometimes these are non-audited kind of statements and so on. So these functions called normally a general accounting function. Beyond that, you have a treasury functions, you have a tax functions, then you have order to cash kind of function, which is basically taking care of all receivables within the company. So whenever sales happens, sometimes it is a cash sales, sometimes if it is a credit sales, then they have to make sure that they receive the payment within this specific timelines, and then collect the cash and transfer it to treasury. So here today we are going to talk about mostly the general accounting functions. Any questions? Or should I move?
So we'll be taking questions in the last session, I mean last 15 minutes.
Sure. Okay.
All right.
Great, thank you. Page, I would like to give you a kind of little bit more detail. When we talked about general accounting, and we talked about six broader functions within the general accounting. So like if you look at the general entries, there are different types of general entries. In our academics also, we do read about the accrual entries. Like utilities, right, or the telephone expenses. Or any expenses which we incur during the month, but we don't pay at that point in time because we don't have an invoice for that. So, but we need to account that for, and we call it as an accrual process, right? If there are any expenses, let's say for transportations, or something which we are paying in cash, we need to account that within the same period. So these are the kind of routine entries, right? Then we have a lot of reclassifications happens every month, because depending upon the nature of the transactions, they need to do a kind of reclassifications. Then audit adjustments happens, basically the auditor's comments, and there are many other entries. And if we talk about these multinational companies, the Fortune 500 companies, they have thousands and thousands of entries every month. And we can understand their vast business model. So companies like Coca-Cola or companies like Abbott, wherein their sales volume is mostly around more than $35 billion per annum. Just assume that you can assume the volume of the general entries, number of vendors they might have, number of suppliers they might have, the transportations, and that business is spread across all more than 100 countries, 150 countries. So number of compliances they have, rules, regulations which they have to follow, and their product quality they need to maintain. So there are hundreds and hundreds of people involved in that. So we can safely assume the volume of general entries. Mostly there are many entries which are repetitive in nature every month. Some entries which are ad hoc in nature, so they need to record as and when they need to incur those expenses or those transactions. And of course then reclassifications and all those kind of things happens. Similarly, in their balance sheet, they have number of different GLs, and whatever be the GLs, cost centers, profit centers they create, they call them as a master data in their mainframe ERP systems, and for their other different country-wise, they might have different systems, but eventually they have to consolidate everything at one level or at a corporate level. So they need to do a lot of reconciliations. So reconciliations could be account reconciliations, it could be invoice reconciliations, it could be bank reconciliations, it could be goods received not invoiced kind of reconciliations, sales reconciliations, and so on. So there are different types of reconciliations they have to perform. So normally these companies have a different department or a different team, or we call it as a center of excellence, which actually keeps on doing different types of reconciliations. Similarly, let's say intercompany accounting happens, which like, and I just want to share an example. Let's say you have a company plant somewhere in Ireland and another plant in USA. So if Ireland plant is supplying some goods to the USA, they need to make sure that the actual profit goes to the Ireland client or Ireland plants, because Ireland is actually a seller, USA is a buyer, so USA will have to pay to Ireland company. So for these types of companies, they have either separate entities within their books, or they have subsidiary companies or something like that, and they need to transfer the goods basis their agreements. Now, some countries have their different regulations in which they need to charge some prices. So they call it as transfer pricing charges. And then transfer pricing, depending upon their taxation systems, they need to have a kind of an agreement, because see, taxation systems are stringent, and they need to make sure that there is no invasion of tax just because of these types of transactions. Because goods is moving from one country to another or one location to another, but for the same company. So there are a lot of rules and regulations behind that which they need to follow. But at the same time, for our accounting team, they have to do a lot of balance confirmations between each other. And this happens because there are different systems between the entities, between the countries and all. So they need to do those kind of things. And I'm just giving you this kind of examples and ideas so that you can correlate how voluminous it is, and the opportunities are vast for the finance professional. You can correlate with all those kind of stuff, right? And then they have to do all intercompany reconciliations. They need to make sure that intercompany recharges are appropriate. They manage the threshold and all those kind of things. Similarly, we talked about fixed assets a little bit, but there are different functions within the fixed assets area. So if somebody acquires a fixed asset, then they need to capitalize the fixed assets. If they create a bigger project, sometimes the project goes on more than 1 year or so. So, like if they set up a plant somewhere or a new machinery is going to set up within the factory, the installation sometimes takes a longer time, more than 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. They need to do a lot of test run. They need to involve different types of departments in that, different labors and all, which they need to capitalize. So they do capitalization, that is the valuations or valuation certificate they receive. So again, I think that those things keeps on coming. So they do a project and settlements, then they run depreciation on a monthly basis. There are systems these days like SAP is one of the systems, Oracle is one of the systems in which they can do a kind of automatic run of all depreciation, all the rates, the method of depreciation, everything is already defining those systems and they can do this, those things. Then whenever like fixed assets is no longer in use, they need to go for a disposal. They need to retire the fixed assets, or maybe sometimes transfer happens between one country to another country and they need to process the transfer. They also have a process of verification of the fixed assets, and they do a kind of tagging on the fixed assets so that they make sure that asset is intact within the organizations and there's no theft or something like that. And then they do a lot of reconciliations between sub-GL to GL, between invoices they receive versus the capitalization, the valuation they receive versus the capitalizations, and after depreciation, the valuations and all those kind of things. So there are a lot of other reconciliation happens. Similarly, there are different then close and consolidation process also is there on a monthly basis. They need to maintain a kind of calendar. They make sure that they close their books on time. They are able to run their trial balance, analyze that, and then convert that into P&L balance sheet and all those kind of stuff. They make sure that their accruals on a month end process automatically. The adjustments happens on time, and the consolidation of books happens on time within the specific timeline, so that they can generate the different reports. So another process is the reporting process. Now reporting is normally divided. Again, there is a separate function within the companies. They call it as financial planning and analysis department. So sometimes some reports are used being created by the FP&A department. Some reports are created by the general accounting team. And another terminology for the general accounting team we call is a record to report kind of a team. So I talked about P2P team, which is accounts payable team, which takes care of all invoicing. Then you have record to report team, which takes care of all general accounting, like recording of general entries, reconciliations, intercompany fixed assets and all reporting kind of stuff. Then you have another team called FP&A, Financial Planning and Analysis, which normally takes care of budgeting, forecasting, and a lot of management kind of reports, P&L analysis, their balance sheet positions on that particular day, and so on. So that's the FP&A team, which requires some specialized skill, some analytical skills to kind of create those kind of reports, and some vision around creating of budgets and all. They collect a lot of data from different people while they create annual budgets, and then they create those things. So I think different departments are divided like that. Then they have the treasury functions, which takes care of all cash transactions. Then they have the tax functions. Now, tax functions normally at a corporate level or at a US level or country level, they have a separate tax functions. And at a country level, like for if they have an operation in India, they have a separate team of tax experts who understands the Indian taxation systems and then file their returns accordingly. So these are the functions.
Yes, the automation of accounting transaction is inevitable, and accountants have to constantly stay relevant by providing these value adds to the businesses. Definitely, sir.
Now, coming to the dimensions, or so if we have to kind of do an assessment of the process or any accounting function or any function for that matter, how do we... what are the criteria on which we need to judge that? In accounting function, it is really important because it's a core functions within any organizations, because it gives you a kind of overall picture of the profit and loss or your balance sheet positions of that particular period as of that particular date, and management can take a decision based on those data. So it's really, really very, very important. The data should be accurate, data should be on time, and management should be able, or they do a kind of business partnering with the management team or operations team, so that they can take a right decision on right time. So we need to see if the overall process, like level of their standardizations, how exactly they are getting the data from their upstream departments. The data flow should be smooth. What kind of policies or policy documentations do they have? Policy documentations should be comprehensive enough so that an accountant or the person sitting in the finance and accounting function can record the transactions according to the policies of the organizations. Then, of course, the controls should be there for each and everything. So like different level of reviews, approval metrics are there, escalation metrics are also defined sometimes on those policy documentations and all those kind of things. Another important aspect is how is their operating model within the organizations. So like I talked about accounts payable functions, general accounting functions, treasury functions, order to cash functions, FP&A and all. They are the separate team sometimes. Sometimes if it is a kind of small organizations, they have one person doing multiple roles. So he is also taking care of invoicing. He is also doing the general accounting piece, recording the journal entries, doing the fixed assets capitalizations. He is also making sure that the sales team is collecting, or the collection team is collecting the payments and treasury and all. So sometimes one person have a multiple role, but this is how we need to define that the operating model of a company should be such that they have a different teams, different responsibilities are defined within the team. Then we need to see what kind of process health and documentations are there, whether let's say if people resign from their job and move to a different company, or somebody is absent on that particular day. This is the documentation, can other person take care of his work? It's all the different things. So it's a kind of risk avoidation as well. The performance measurement systems should be there. So if let's say different cutoff dates are there, I should be, as an accountant, should be able to turn around the entire process as per the defined timelines. And then the most important piece is technology, which is a kind of buzzword these days. And there are different systems. So you have systems of records wherein we record the transactions. So think of a general entry which we record in a systems. And there are different ways to record the transactions. Like we upload the Excel file, we key in the data within the systems. Or maybe if there is a kind of robotics process, which we will talk on a later page. They can directly feed the data into that. Then systems of engagement, and I will take you through with those things. I have a separate page for that. systems of intelligence, which we talked about, like robotics, process automation, artificial intelligence, and so on. Systems of collaboration is like one we are using right now, like Google Meet. So we are collaborating with each other on that, Zoom and those kind of things.
Okay. Exactly.
I'll take you on that.
Yes. Definitely, this intelligent automation offers a more comprehensive and real-time view of business performance, and this to the benefit of both the finance and every other part of the organization. Very well said, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Nidhi. So, just a kind of brief definition, just to understand, or maybe I know you guys must be reading all those kind of things. And these days, these are the buzzwords, right? So we keep on talking about artificial intelligence. We keep on talking about machine learning. We keep on talking about robotics. Robotics is very common these days. Machine learning is also very common these days. I'll just give you some examples. So let's say we talked about the invoices which comes from the supplier, right? And those invoices comes in emails. So if there are hundreds of emails coming in per day on a specified email address, robotics can actually download those invoices and pick up the defined fields from those invoices and feed into your mainframe systems like SAP. SAP is the mainframe system, or Oracle or IBM or any kind of a system. They can feed it. The RPA can feed in that. So it's a pure transactional work, and many of you know, and you must have seen that, like, we used to do a kind of tally based accounting earlier. So people used to create a kind of voucher, and when we used to hire one accountant or Munimji somewhere, they used to punch the data in the tally software. But those things are now can be taken care by the robotics automation tool. Not for the small enterprises, but I think big companies, because RPA has its cost, its own sweet cost.